Well, good morning. How's everybody doing today? I got to let you know something. We want to give a special greeting to, for the first time ever, right now as we speak, live via video, the brand new North End Church of the Rock campus going right now in Selkirk Avenue. So you want to make them feel at home. Well, this morning my message is entitled, A Speck in Time. I'm wondering how many of you in this room have ever contemplated your existence in the vastness of the universe. How many of you have done that? You've asked that big question or you've wondered about it. We all should ask that question from time to time. We're going to ask it today if you've never asked yourself before. I remember when I was a kid growing up, we used to spend our summers on Delta Beach on Lake Manitoba. Anybody ever been to Delta Beach? It used to be a beautiful beach. The sand went on as far as the eye could see practically. Today the water levels are high and pretty much lap your front step. But I remember when we were growing up, I was maybe, I don't know, 7 or 8 years old, and we were sitting around the campfire. And of course, without the city lights, and if you look up at the sky, it's an incredible sight. And I remember one night we're sitting around the campfire and you could see the Milky Way out there. You could see some planets. You could see Venus and Pluto and Donald and Mickey. You could see them all. And we were sitting out there and I was just sort of overwhelmed. And I said to my father who was sitting beside me, I said, there must be like a million stars up there. And he says, let me tell you something, Mark. There's actually more stars in the universe than there is sand on this beach. And I just couldn't comprehend that because the sand was everywhere. I mean, the sand was in my shoes, it was in my bed sheets, it was in my shorts. That's too much information, right? But I mean, it was just everywhere. And I couldn't imagine that there'd be more stars up there than there was sand on the ground. And for a moment, I began to have a bit of a mortality crisis. And I was thinking like, well, why am I here then? Look at the expanse of it, and how come I can exist in this, and why was I put here? And I think that's the big question that we all ask. And see, eventually I got to the point where I realized, and I know why, because of God's creation, I know who I am in the midst of that. But I think we all have that moment, don't we? Where we look at the universe, and we look at the greatness, and we all of a sudden feel like nothing more than a speck in time. Or a speck of dust or a grain of sand. And whether the universe is 6,000 years old or 6 billion, it doesn't really matter. We are very insignificant in the greater scheme of things. Yet, for some reason, God has put us here for a divine purpose, and that's what we're going to talk about this morning. I want you to think about a man named David who wrote the Psalms, who one day, I suppose, and I'm imagining he was doing this while he was tending his sheep out late at night and looking at the stars, and he had his own existential crisis. And it was in Psalm chapter 8, and he says this. He says, when I consider the heavens and the work of your fingers, the stars and the moon which you have ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you visit him? Are you getting that picture? Are you imagining that young shepherd boy looking at the sky and all of a sudden beginning to wonder, why am I here? Why would you even consider me? I am so small and so insignificant in the greater scheme of things, which was true. But yet, at the same time, David knew that he had a divine purpose because God does visit you, because God is mindful of you. Every single person in this room has a God-given divine purpose for your existence. Nobody is here by accident. Let me show you that picture of the galaxy again. Here's a picture of the galaxy. You are here. In case you're wondering where you are here. The bigger question isn't where you are. The bigger question is, why are you here? That's the question I think we all need to wrestle with, don't we? Why am I here? As I look around the room, I see a few people here that are my age or older, and they'll probably remember this. How many remember a book in the 1970s called A Hitchhiker's Guide to Europe? Anybody remember that? A few hands, they're all my age. And there's the cover of it. And this book was amongst many books in the 70s about traveling through Europe. Europe on $5 a day, Europe on $7 a day, Europe on $9 a day. And then there was The Hitchhiker's Guide to Europe, which, incidentally, has gone down in history as the number one book ever stolen from libraries. And so I remember in the 70s, my brother was in high school. He was reading this book. I remember it being on his bedside. And he was reading this book. And when he graduated from high school, he went to Europe and he hitchhiked through Europe using the guide. Now, one of the things that the guide talks about was that you don't really need money. All you need to be a hitchhiker in Europe is your towel. And as long as you have a towel, you will get by and get through. So I remember when my brother left, he left looking something like Paul McCartney. He came back looking more like Ozzy Osbourne. Never washed or cut his hair for the 9 months that he was gone. But the one thing he did return with was his towel. And I remember him handing it to my mother and saying, "Can you wash the towel?" She burned it. it was beyond washing. Well, at the same time my brother was hitchhiking through Europe was another young man from Britain by the name of Douglas Adams. And he was hitchhiking through, and he was lying out in the night looking at the stars and looking at the night sky. And he said to his companion, his traveling companion, "What we really need is a hitchhiker's guide to the galaxy." And then some of you know the story that he went back to England and he wrote a radio series that ran for a number of years called The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. There was 5 books that came out of it. And in 2005, there was the motion picture movie, Hitchhiker's Guide. Let's show the picture. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. How many have seen the movie? People all under 40. For the next couple of minutes, those of you over 40, you're not going to understand what I'm talking about. The rest of you are going to be kind of digging it. And here's what the book was all about, or the movie was all about, was this. There was a supercomputer named Deep Thought, and it was contemplating the great question, the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything. It spent 7.5 million years calculating the answer to life, universe, and everything, and came up with the answer, and the answer was 42. We have some pop culture junkies in the room. Now, I know you're sitting there going, "What does that mean?" Nothing. It doesn't mean anything. Don't get too carried away. It's science fiction. But don't miss the ultimate question. The ultimate question is, why are we here? What is the meaning of life? And that's the question every one of us needs to answer, because I got news for you. Guess what? You are a hitchhiker in the galaxy. The Bible actually tells you that you are a hitchhiker. It uses a more archaic word. Who can tell me what it is? Sojourners. I heard it. Thanks for coming, Pastor Keith. The word is sojourners that the Bible uses, and that's a traveler, someone who's just traveling through, someone who doesn't live there. The Bible describes us as sojourners. The Bible describes us as hitchhikers. This is not our home. We are just passing through. We are hitchhikers on the planet Earth, careening through the galaxy at a breakneck speed. And every one of us, even though this isn't our home, we have a purpose why we are here. And our challenge is to figure out why we are here. I don't know about you, but I don't actually pick up hitchhikers, do you? And you know what I do? I imagine that they're giving me a thumbs up for good driving when I go by. "Hey, way to go, thanks for not hitting me." So that's what I figure is going on there. How about this guy? You gotta see this picture. Gotta show you this one. There you go, state prison, next exit. "Do not pick up hitchhikers, will not kill you." Yeah, I'm picking up that guy. Well, if you have a Bible with you this morning, we're going to be going to Philippians chapter 3. And there's more in this passage about destiny than you could possibly ever imagine. And we're going to read 3 verses here, starting at verse 12. And it says this: "Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay a hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid a hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself as to having apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting the things which are behind and reaching forward to the things which are ahead, I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call in Christ Jesus." Now, I hope there was a line in there you didn't miss. He says, not that I have attained, not that I have been perfected, but I press forward that I may lay a hold of that for which Christ Jesus laid a hold of me. Did you catch that? That he said his purpose in life is to lay a hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of him. Or in other words, don't miss it, his divine purpose, right? Why did Christ lay hold of you? Why did he die on the cross for you? Why has he put you here on planet Earth? That is your purpose. And our challenge is to lay a hold of that for which Christ has laid a hold of us. Now, here's what's really ironic about Paul saying this. The stage of life that he is at the end of his life. He wrote this from prison in Rome about 3 or 4 years before he expired, if I can put it in kind terms. And we look at the last few years of his life. He spent 2 years in prison where he wrote Ephesians and Philippians, where he talked here about how his journey was not done, and how his goal was to lay hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of him. I want you to think about this. He's already written 2/3 of the New Testament. He's already done his missionary journeys. He's only 3 or 4 years away from being, what happened? He got released from prison, rearrested, back into prison, and beheaded. And yet, right near the end of his life, he is still saying, my goal is to lay a hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of me. Every one of us in this room, regardless whether we're young or old or somewhere in between, our goal needs to be to lay a hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of you. Now, I'm going to give you three parts of this journey that I think we're going to find in the verse. And this is what they are. The first one is this. You need to put the past in the past. You need to put the present into perspective. And you need to put the future into focus. Don't you love alliteration? You can use it over and over again. And here's the message. The first thing we need to do is to put the past in the past. I want you to think about what he says. He says, not that I have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting the things which are behind. He says, if you're gonna lay hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of you, there's one thing you have to do. The one starting place is this. You got to forget the things which are behind. You have to put the past in the past. Let me ask you a question. Do you think Paul knew anything about that? Do you think he had any regrets? Do you think he had anything that he had to live down from his past? Anybody think? Maybe? Maybe? Huh? Who was Paul the apostle before he was Paul the apostle? Yeah, he was Saul of Tarsus. Do you remember who he was? He was the persecutor of the church. He was the one who was out to destroy the church. He was out persecuting the church. He was the one who stood by and consented to the death of Stephen. Stephen was the one who was stoned while he was preaching, which in those days meant something completely different. He wasn't some sort of hipster postmodern preacher. You understand that. And this was Paul. And Paul describes himself as the chief of something. What was it? Chief of sinners. He says, though I am the chief of sinners, Paul actually became the chief of apostles. How does he go from chief of sinners to chief of the apostles? How is it? Because he was able to put the past in the past. He had a lot to live down. Why would the church even want to listen to this guy? He was the guy that was putting Christians to death. He was the guy that was persecuting the church. But he understood that because of the work of the cross and the blood of Jesus, his past was behind him. And he says, one thing I do, forgetting the things which are behind. You know what that means for you and me? That means whatever you have done, wherever you have been, you are not disqualified. You know, there's people in this room right now, and you think, well, you don't know what I've done. You don't know how bad I've been. You know what? I don't want to know, probably. But God knows, and you know what? He has forgiven you. I don't care what you've done. I don't care where you've been. I don't care how bad and surly you think you are. There is nothing you have done that is so egregious that God's Son and the work of his cross isn't able to wipe it away so that you can put it behind you, because he says, your sins and your unrighteous deeds, I will remember no more. That's pretty exciting news. And it's not like God's so old he can't remember anymore, that he's lost his memory. He chooses to forget. So if he has chosen to put them behind you, if he has chosen to forget, then why wouldn't you do it? Why wouldn't you put your past in your past? You will never get on with your journey to lay a hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of you until you can figure out how to put your past in your past. I want to tell you the story this morning about Serge Leclerc. Serge Leclerc, there's a picture of him. He was in Winnipeg a few years ago. I had an opportunity to hear him speak and hear his story. Also had an opportunity to meet this man personally. And his story is an incredible one of God's grace. He was born in an abandoned warehouse in Montreal to a 13-year-old Cree girl, and he was the product of rape. He ended up growing up in a residential school where he was abused physically and sexually. He retaliated against one of his abusers and stabbed him with a knife. He got labeled as brain damaged, a label which he wore as a badge of honor, actually, for the next number of years. By the time he was 15, he was living on the streets of Montreal. He was carrying a gun. He was running a gang. He had a still. He was selling alcohol. He was selling drugs. And he rose up through the crime ranks of the city of Montreal. 1984, it all came crashing down when he was convicted in a $40 million drug bust and sentenced to 9 years in prison. He ended up in prison in solitary confinement, because that's where they put people like him, lonely, broken, completely disenfranchised from his world, thinking that really his life had come to an end. One day, a prison worker, Christian prison worker, a brave one, I might add, asked to visit him and went and saw him in solitary confinement. And when Serge wouldn't have anything to do with him, he just said one thing to him when parting. He said, let me ask you something. He says, are you going to go through the rest of your life as being nothing more than an animal on planet Earth? Or are you going to see yourself as a son of God who has a God-given divine purpose and discover what that is. Those are his parting words as he laid on the table at Gideon's New Testament Bible, and he left. Serge picked up the Bible. Guess what? He had nothing but time on his hands. And he began to read at Matthew. And all of a sudden, he began to identify with this man named Jesus, because Jesus was just like him. You say, how's that? Well, he said, here was a gang leader. He had a gang of 12, and they were marauding through the Holy Land. He totally related to Jesus. And then, of course, he was so surprised when the gang leader got killed, and the gang carried on without any regard to their life. And he thought to himself, what was it that they had discovered that they were willing to risk their lives for the cause that this man had brought them? And in that moment, he realized he had discovered the truth, and he knelt down in his bed, and he gave his heart to the Lord Jesus Christ in solitary confinement in that prison that day. Everything changed. Everything changed for Serge that day. He began to study. He began to go to university. He became the first man in Canadian history to ever graduate from university while still in prison by correspondence. In 1988, he was released from prison. He was given a full pardon, and he became the director of the Saskatchewan Teen Challenge, which was a ministry to drug and alcohol abusers. And he ran there for a number of years. Then in 2007, he runs for politics and runs for a seat in the Legislative Assembly of Saskatchewan. He becomes an MLA for Saskatoon. He said this might be the first time in history that the lawbreaker has become the lawmaker. See, usually it's the other way around, right? And so anyway, so for the next 3 years, he served his province in the legislature of Saskatchewan. And then 2010, this is a little bit of a footnote to the story. In 2010, the media accused him of being involved in drugs again. There was some sort of tape that had surfaced. He resigned his seat to clear his name, only to discover that he had cancer. And within the year, Serge Leclerc was dead. Now, I know some of you look at that and say, see, he fell back into his old ways. Well, we don't actually know that. He said that he was innocent. But here's what the most important thing. I actually met the man. And I actually looked into his eyes. And I can tell you this, that he was a changed man. Here was a man that was a criminal on the streets. Here was a man whose life was darker than probably anybody in this room. And yet God changed him from the inside out. God lifted him up, raised him up, put him actually into a place of politics and influence where he was actually a lawmaker, changed and transformed this man's life. Why? Because he understood he could put his past in his past, because he put the things behind him. He, in my opinion, whether he was guilty or not of that last thing, it doesn't matter to me. You know why? He's a trophy of God's grace. Here was a man, having met him, I can tell you that he was changed. God was able to take a broken, lost, despicable sinner and make him into a trophy of his grace. That's the good news in this story. It reminds me of this other story. One day we got St. Peter. He's working the pearly gates. Why is he always working the gates? Why does this man have to work so hard? But anyway, he's working the pearly gates, and these four convicts show up at the gates. He's a little nervous. Big, huge, muscular guys, shaved heads, jail host tattoos all over him. He's shaking a little bit, and they said, we want in. And he checks the book, and he says, I'm sorry, your names aren't in the book. And they said, check again. Nervously, he says, well, I'm going to have to go ask a higher power. So he goes off, and he says, God, what do I do? I've got four convicts at the gates, and they want in. He says, well, you know the deal, Peter. You know the criteria. If they don't meet the criteria, you got to send them packing. So he goes back, and about 5 minutes later, he's back at God's throne. He says, well, they're gone. He says, the convicts? He says, nope, the pearly gates. Didn't see that coming, did you? So the first thing we see in this passage is this, is that we need to put the past in the past. One thing I do, forgetting the things which are behind. But then he goes on and he says this, not that I have apprehended. Not that I have apprehended. What is he doing? He is putting the present into perspective. Here he is. He's at the end of his life. He's probably the most influential character in Scripture, except for Jesus. And yet he says, not that I have apprehended, not that I have attained, not that I have perfected. He says, I'm still carrying on my journey because I am not at the end yet. I'm not done. He's only 3 or 4 years from being executed. He's at the end of his life. He is past middle age. And yet he says, my goal is to keep moving forward. I'm not done yet. And the reason this is important for us to put our present into perspective is because of the culture we live in. A lot of times what happens is we become complacent. And we become satisfied with what life has to offer us. And we just start drifting along and going through the motions and living every day like the day before. And you get up and you go to work and you come home and you watch the news, you go to bed, only to wake up the next day and do it again. You see, if you're not learning and growing and stretching, if you're not moving forward every single day, then you're not really living. And see, it's the reason why men in particular, but also women, why they go through midlife crisis. Right? Because they're on the treadmill, they're just going through the motions, and they got the wife and the house and the kids, and all of a sudden one day they wake up and they look at their life and they go, is this all there is to it? Is this all there is? Because guess what? That isn't all there is to it. And that's why they go through this midlife crisis and they begin to dismantle their life, usually for the negative. See, I always like to describe midlife this way. Midlife is the time when your glass is finally half full, but unfortunately you have to start putting your teeth in it overnight. Right? How many of you have ever read the book Good to Great by Jim Collins? Anybody read that book in the room? A few people. One of the best business books out there. And he has a principle in there that I think is particularly helpful for this discussion. And it's this. It's to confront the brutal facts. And what he talks about is the fact that companies get complacent. And they just get on the treadmill and they just go through the motions. And they don't realize that when you're coasting, you can only coast downhill. And he says what they need to do is they have to confront the brutal facts. And see, I think it applies to life. I think we can coast downhill. I think we can get to that point where we're not really moving forward anymore, and we're just on the treadmill, and we're just going through the motions. And we need to confront the brutal facts. We need to put the present into perspective and say, where am I? Why am I here? And where should I be going? What should I be doing? And more importantly, what do you need to change to get there? One of the great examples that he uses on this point is the story of Admiral Jim Stockdale. Jim Stockdale was, here's a picture of him, he was the highest ranked military U.S. official to become a prisoner of war during the Vietnam conflict. He spent 8 years being tortured in incarceration. He was given no prisoner's rights. He had no estimated date of release, and he just languished away for 8 long years, and yet somehow he managed to endure it, and he emerged from the other side. And so he was asked this question, how did you survive? And he says, I survived because I never lost sight of the end story. I knew that one day, I would be released. But in the meantime, I had to prevail over all the adversity that I had to face every single day, knowing that dealing with that conflict would eventually make me a better person and that it would become the defining moment of my life, which it was when he finally got out. So then he was asked this question and said, who didn't get out? And he said, frankly, the optimists. The people that thought they were going to get released the next day or the next week were the people who died in there because they weren't prepared to confront the brutal facts. And you see, that's how we put the present into perspective. You got to look at your life and you got to ask the hard questions. Are you where you want to be in life? Are you where you should be in life? If not, what needs to change in order for you to move forward? That's the hard question, right? You can't move forward unless something changes in your life. I'm going to give you a little psychology lesson. Boy, some of you are excited about this. But I am. I'm going to give you a little psychology lesson. Trust me, it's going to fit. In psychology, they talk about this thing called self-evaluation. And there's three different motives or three different ways that people look at self-evaluation. And look at the screen, I'm going to show you what they are. And what they are is this, they're self-enhancement, self-verification, or self-assessment. And they've been distinguished quite differently. And so let me talk about these three, and then you begin to look at your own life and honestly ask yourself where you are. The first one is this, it's self-enhancement. And people are doing self-evaluation, but what they do is they want a favorable outcome. Who wouldn't, right? And so what they do is they discard any information, input, or opinion that is negative in any way, so that they can only look at themselves in a positive light. And there's lots of people who are like this. Generally, it's people with inflated self-esteem. They only want to hear good stuff, and if there's anything negative, I don't want to hear it, and I'm not going to receive it, and I'm not going to talk about it. You want a great example from Scripture about that? It was actually David. When David was at his lowest moment, and that was during his time with Bathsheba, he committed this terrible sin. He committed adultery with Bathsheba, he got her pregnant, he conspired and had her husband, Uriah, murdered. Then he went and married the woman, and even though they lost the child, you know what David did? He went on his merry way, leading the nation and acting and feeling like somehow he was justified and somehow he was still a righteous man. But the prophet Nathan came along and corrected him very carefully, right? You correct a king carefully. And what he did was he told him a story, told him a parable. And he says, let me tell you about a man, David. There was this man who owned many sheep, many lambs, and he had a visitor come to him, and he wanted to prepare him a feast. And so his neighbor had only one small lamb, and he took his neighbor's lamb and slaughtered it to feed his guest. And it says that David was incensed and said, "Who is this man? Such a one should be killed." Nice righteous proclamation, right? And Nathan carefully again said, "You are that man." You see, he wasn't able to see the fact that his life was a shell. He wasn't able to see the fact that he actually had some serious problems, worse than almost anybody around him, and he wasn't willing to confront the brutal facts that he was in a miserable state at that moment. And it took somebody else to come and carefully speak into it so that he would begin to see who he was and what he was. Now, the second form of this is self-verification. Self-verification is when people already have a preconceived idea of who they are, and it may or may not be true, but it's who you think you are. And what you do is you seek for people to confirm who you already think you are. And you may not be right, but you want people to agree with you. And a lot of times, people who have low self-esteem fall into this because they think they're somehow miserable, unworthy human beings. And so they tell people, "I'm miserable and I'm worthy," and they're expecting someone to say, "Yeah, you're right. You're miserable. You're a loser." And so we find a great example of Moses. Moses is 40 years in the wilderness. Now think about it. Any sense of pride or any sense of self-esteem that he might have had was a long time gone. He had been 40 years in the backside of the wilderness, and he had all of Egypt and all of his history and all of his pride completely purged out of him. And yet, after 40 years, God visits him, and God says, through the burning bush, "I'm going to send you back into Egypt, and I want you to get my people out of there, and I want you to confront the Pharaoh and say, 'Let my people go.'" What does Moses do? Moses contends with God and says, "I can't do it. You know I can't do it. And the reason I can't do it is I am slow of tongue and slow of speech. Why don't you send someone else, someone who speaks better? Why don't you send my brother Aaron? He speak good." Well, how did God react to that? What was Moses waiting for? Moses was waiting for, "You know what? Moses, you're right. You are a loser. Thanks for pointing that out to me. I didn't notice. And you're right, Aaron's better. I'll take Aaron." He was expecting that. That's not what God does. God gets mad at him. And it says, God's anger was kindled towards Moses and says, "Who is it that makes the deaf to hear? Who is it that makes the mute to speak? Who is it that made your mouth and made your tongue? And I will be with you and you will speak." Moses was all of a sudden, whoa, he has a different opinion of me than I have. Guess what? God always has a different opinion of you than you have. And guess what? It's usually a good one. He likes you a lot. And so that's self-verification. We are looking for someone to see us the way we see ourselves, which may not be accurate. Now, the last and the final thing is what they call self-assessment or true self-assessment. And this is where, in a sort of a sense of uncertainty, you want to find out who you really are. Because as I've said so far, most of us, guess what, people? Most of us don't really see ourselves how we really are. Let me show you a picture of Homer Simpson to illustrate this. Catch this. There's Homer. He doesn't have an honest and a clear depiction of who he really is. And you know what? Most of us don't. We need to go through a true self-assessment where what we do is we come to people that we know and people we trust, and we ask them in honest, uncertain terms, "Who am I? What do I need to change? What things in my life do I need to change in order for me to move forward?" How many of you think that sounds a little bit scary? But that's what we need to do. You ask the honest question. You know, the best example of it, and it was a guy that actually didn't need to change, and it was a guy that actually knew who he was, but it was actually Jesus. Jesus came to Peter one day. Do you remember the question? He said, "Who do men say I, the Son of Man, am?" And Peter says, "Well, some say Jeremiah or Elijah or one of the prophets." He says, "Who do you say I am?" Now, Jesus knew who he was, but don't miss the importance of the question. The question is, who do men think I am? Who do you think I am? You are not who you think you are, but you are often who others think you are. And you need to find out how people see you. Because guess what? We have blind spots. And we need our friends. And we need people around us. If you are going to put the present into perspective, you're going to have to find out who you really are. And you're going to have to find out, what do I need to change in order to move forward? Let me tell you a story about a young man that came and visited me a few years ago. And he sat down in my office, and he was itching to get into the ministry. And he said, Pastor Mark, I'm ready for the ministry. I'm ready to get into the ministry. And I said to him, you know, you're actually not ready for ministry until others see that you are ready for ministry. I said, this is my advice to you. I would go to people that you know and know you, and I would ask them to give you an honest answer. Am I ready for ministry? So he said, okay, I'll do that. He says, I think I'll start with you. Do you think I'm ready for ministry? I said, nope. He was not expecting that. He was devastated. He was not expecting the no. And then he started going around asking other people, am I ready? Am I ready? Am I ready? And they went, not really. You've got some character things that you need to work on. And you know what? Because he did an honest assessment of who he was, he found out what things that he had to change. Catch this. He changed those things. Did I mention that this man is one of our pastors on staff here today at Church of the Rock? Did I tell you that? That's the end of that story, and it's a good one. You should be cheering. That could be you someday. There's like this story of this psychology professor. He was giving an object lesson to his students one day, and he took an empty glass jar and he filled it with some stones, and he said to the class, is the jar full? And they said, yeah, it looks full. So then he took some pebbles and he put the pebbles in and he shook it and they filled in the voids. He says, now is it full? They said, now it's full. And then he took some sand and he poured the sand in it and he shook that and the sand filled it. And he says, now is it full? And they said, yeah, now it actually does look full. And then he gave his object lesson. And he said, this is a picture of your life. And the stones are the important things in your life. They're your spouse and they're your kids and they're your family and they're your friends and they're the things that really matter. They're others in your life. Those are the big things. And the pebbles, they're important. They're important things. They're things like your job and things like your house and things like your car and your food. Those are important things in life, but they're not the most important thing. And he said, the sand is just the small stuff. The sand is the stuff that doesn't really matter. But if you fill your life with the sand, if you fill the jar with the sand first, think about it. You can't put the stones and the pebbles in it. There's no room for the important things in your life because you filled it with unimportant things. Well, everybody was impressed except one young man. He put up his hand. He said, may I illustrate this a little further? The professor said, yes. He pulled out a bottle of beer from his knapsack. He came to the jar and he gently poured the lager into the sand, which soaked it all up. And the professor said, and your point is? He said, my point is, no matter how full your life seems, there's always room for beer. That part's a joke. You know that, eh? Just so we're all clear about that. So what do we learn from this passage? The first thing is this. You need to put the past in the past. Second thing is you need to put the present into perspective. And the last final thing is this. You need to put the future in focus. And Paul says, I'm going to forget the things which are behind. And not that I have attained or have apprehended or have arrived. But he says, I press towards the upper call of the goal of Christ Jesus. He says, I press towards the upper call, that I may lay a hold of that for which Christ laid a hold of me. That's the whole point here. That I may lay a hold of my divine purpose, my greater purpose. You say, Pastor Mark, we're running out of time. What's my greater purpose? You know what? You have to figure out what the greater purpose is, but I'll give you a little snapshot. I'll tell you what it's going to look like. The greater purpose is when you begin to live for a purpose greater than yourself. As long as you're living for yourself, you're never going to be fulfilled. You're never going to be happy. You're never going to have that sense of destiny and purpose in your life. It's only what you do for others that actually ultimately matters in the long run. I want you to think about this. When you're lying in the tomb, when you're lying in the casket that day, what matters? Does the job you have, the money you make, the car you drove, the house you lived in? None of that's going to matter. The only thing that's going to matter at that moment is how you enhanced and enriched the lives of other people around you. Think about all the great people that have gone before us. Who are the people that have really gone down in history of being the greats? Were they the actors and the authors? Actually, probably not. They were the people that were great humanitarians that made their world a better place. They were the people like Louis Pasteur and Abraham Lincoln and Martin Luther King Jr. and Oscar Schindler and Mother Teresa. These are the people who didn't live their lives for themselves, but they lived for the greater purpose, a purpose greater than themselves. And you say, well, I'm never going to be them. No, you aren't. I know that. I'm not going to be them either. That's not the point. Every one of us in our small way can make others feel better and greater in their life. That's what it's all about. We all have an ability, every single one of us, to enhance and enrich the lives of people around us. That's the only thing that's going to matter in the long run. That is the greater purpose. Your divine purpose is somehow intrinsically related to how you affect other people in your life. If you want to be happy for an hour, take a nap. If you want to be happy for a day, go fishing. You want to be happy for a week? Go on a vacation. You want to be happy for a month? Get married. You want to be happy for a lifetime? Help someone else. You will find that the greatest fulfillment you ever get is not what you do for yourself, but what you do for others. Our goal in life should be to lay a hold of that for which Christ has also laid a hold of us. How do we do it? We put our past in the past, our present into perspective, and we put our future into focus. Let's stand together, shall we? I need you all to bow your heads and close your eyes just for a moment, if you would, today. Because I know in this room there are people who have not yet begun the journey. You have not yet been able to put your past in the past because you haven't invited Jesus into your life, having received the work of the cross to forgive and remit all your sins so it's not hanging over your head. And if you're here today and you've never done that, if you're here today and you've never had that definitive moment where you've invited Jesus into your life, and I'm not saying you've been to church or been baptized as an infant, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about coming to that place where you surrender to Him and you invite His Lordship into your existence, and you receive the gift of salvation and the forgiveness of sins. I'm going to make it really simple. I'm not going to call you forward. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. I'm not going to single you out. But with every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here today and you have not yet begun that journey, you have not been able to fully put your past in your past, right where you are, nobody's looking around, I want you to slip up your hand. You're not sure if you were to die tonight? If you go to heaven, I'm talking to you. A bunch of hands going up today. Who else wants to join these people? Take a minute. Yep, all over the room, there's hands going up. I appreciate that. Nobody's looking around. I'm not going to call you forward. Anybody else want to join these folks? Just take a moment. All right, you can put your hands down. I said it wouldn't single anybody out, so let's all pray together today, shall we? Lord Jesus, I thank you for the work of the cross. That you died for my sin. That I could put my past in the past. And then you rose again, and you forever live to be my Lord. That I could put my present in perspective. And that I could focus on this, then I might lay a hold of that for which you laid a hold of me. My divine and heavenly purpose. I thank you that this day I begin the journey in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Let's give Jesus a hand today, shall we?